Bea here, and welcome back to Environmental Science. Can you guess what we're exploring today? The largest part of the hydrosphere, the Earth's oceans. This is one of the saltwater systems of Earth that we learned about in our last lesson. Today, we're headed out to the open ocean, the area away from shore. But we're not just going to stay at the surface. We're going to plunge beneath the waves and travel all the way to the ocean floor. What kind of conditions and life do you think we'll find along the way? I'm really hoping to find a humpback anglerfish. These creatures are so bizarre looking that they may seem like the imaginings of myth and legend, but they're really out there somewhere. These unique fish can produce their own light and are highly adapted to life in dark, nutrient-poor waters. So keep an eye out as we explore. What part of the ocean do you think we might find them in? We're going to head offshore and start our exploration of the open ocean in the epipelagic zone. Did you know that the prefix epi is Greek for over or on top of? Where then do you think we would find the epipelagic zone of the ocean? The epipelagic zone is right at the surface and extends down as much as 200 meters below. This region is known as the sunlight zone. Any guesses why? Sunlight easily penetrates the water here, making the conditions very hospitable for much-loved creatures such as whales, dolphins, and a myriad of fish and other sea creatures. What you may not be as familiar with, however, are the photosynthetic life forms living here, such as marine algae and kelp. With plentiful water and sunlight, how do you think we would describe the productivity in the epipelagic zone? Remember that productivity refers to the amount of biomass produced from photosynthesis. Pause the video for a moment and make a prediction in your notes. You may have guessed that it is high, but did you know that the oxygen produced from photosynthesis in the epipelagic zone of the ocean accounts for approximately 50% of the total oxygen produced on Earth? The ocean quite literally breathes life into our planet. If we were to drop 200 meters below the surface and continue traveling downward, we would enter the mesopelagic zone, also known as the twilight zone. Why do you think it's called the twilight zone? Does any light reach the mesopelagic zone, which extends as deep as 1,000 meters below the surface? As its nickname implies, some filtered light reaches the mesopelagic, enough to support creatures such as these giant cuttlefish, as well as this bobtail squid. It's getting pretty dark down here. Once we get deep enough that no more light from the surface can be seen, we have reached the end of the mesopelagic zone. Reaching down to a depth of 4,000 meters, the bathypelagic, or midnight zone, is actually the largest ecosystem on Earth, and it exists in nearly complete darkness. The only light here comes from the bioluminescence of organisms such as these deep-sea jellyfish, or these unique creatures that emit light to attract prey. Given that it has the prefix bio, what do you think bioluminescence means? It is the production of light from a living organism and is a common adaptation in dark environments. The midnight zone is a strange, dark world so unfamiliar to us that we might feel like we're on an alien planet. With no sunlight, there is no photosynthesis, and the unusual glowing creatures down here must find creative ways to obtain food. But our journey is going to take us deeper still. Do you think there could possibly be life at a deeper, colder, darker place than this? If we continued down past the bathypelagic zone, we would end in the abyssopelagic zone, or just the abyss, as it is commonly known. With a name like that, what would we expect to find here? Not much, probably. After all, the pressure is immensely high and the temperature is very cold. However, life is pretty crafty at carving out a niche in even the most hostile conditions, and this is no exception. A few species such as spider crabs and deep sea cucumbers are quite successful in this void of a landscape. So, we've made it all the way down to the abyss, nearly 6,000 meters below the ocean surface. But we're not quite to the bottom yet. Let's end our journey at the very deepest part of the ocean. To find it, we'll travel to the western Pacific off the coast of Guam. There, we'll find the Mariana Trench, which is the deepest known location on the surface of Earth. The Mariana Trench extends to a depth of nearly 11,000 meters, almost twice the depth of the abyss. How is that possible? In some parts of the ocean, the movement of continental plates causes a deep trench to form. These trenches are known as the Hadal Zone. Though almost devoid of life, we do find snailfish and other microorganisms here that can survive without sunlight. Before we head back up from the bottom of the ocean, do you remember what we are looking for on our journey today? Where do you think we might have passed the humpback anglerfish? Remember that it is adapted to cold, dark waters with few nutrients. Which of the zones that we explored do you think it might be hiding in? Pause the video for a moment and make a prediction. Then we'll see if you're right. The two zones closest to the surface, the sunlight and twilight zones, receive too much sunlight. The anglerfish's bioluminescent abilities wouldn't be of much use here. And while we do find some life in the abyss and the trenches, it's few and far between. We're most likely to spot a humpback anglerfish in the midnight zone, where it's dark and cold, but still well populated with a variety of life forms. And there it is, a humpback anglerfish in the bathypelagic zone. Though he's keeping some rather unusual company, I think his two friends might be a little lost. Hopefully they'll find their way to shallower water soon. But this dark, cold habitat is perfect for the anglerfish. As you have seen, our oceans are teeming with their own life and are critical to life on land because of the oxygen they produce, as well as their influence on global weather patterns that we discussed in our last lesson. But it's not always smooth sailing in the ocean. One of the biggest threats to our ocean is trash, particularly plastic. Plastic is invading our oceans at an alarming rate, even at depths where the anglerfish lives. Marine organisms such as sea turtles and seabirds are routinely found with large quantities of plastic in their digestive system. Where do you think this plastic comes from? Waste from single-use plastics such as water bottles and plastic bags often end up in the ocean, even if we don't intentionally put them there. Why do you think this is so problematic? Consider a sea turtle whose favorite meal is a jellyfish. To their untrained eyes, what do you think they see in both of these cases? A jellyfish. Only one of them isn't a jellyfish at all. It's a plastic bag. And eating it will likely cause a blockage in the sea turtle's digestive system that can be fatal. But plastic isn't our only concern. Oil spilling from ships contaminates the water, putting marine life at risk, and across the globe, climate change threatens to alter marine ecosystems in ways that we can't always predict or fix in a timely manner, The good news is that we are learning more about marine ecosystems every day. And with modern technology, we now have a unique ability to reverse many of these threats and restore ecosystems to a healthy state if we're willing to make the effort. As we went through the lesson today, we explored the major zones of the ocean and began considering some of the threats that our oceans face. Later in the course, we'll take a more in-depth look at these challenges and how scientists, as well as people just like you, are working to overcome them. Until next time, remember, each of our actions creates a ripple effect that can grow into big waves. Dive in, stay curious, and keep learning.